Ladies and gentlemen, the program is about to begin. Please take your seats and silence your cell phones. Thank you. Please welcome Don Evans, Chairman of the George W. Bush Foundation Board of Directors.
And good evening, and welcome to the Bush Center. I am Don Evans, Chairman of the Board of the George W. Bush Foundation. Thank you all for joining us tonight for the first graduation of the Presidential Leadership Scholars Program. This program is a partnership among three presidential centers in Texas: the George W. Bush Presidential Center, the George H.W. Bush Foundation, the LBJ Presidential Library Foundation, and our neighboring Presidential Foundation in Arkansas, the Clinton Foundation. And today we are here to celebrate the 60 graduates of the first class of the program. Before we begin the program today, I want to acknowledge several special guests we have with us: members of the Presidential Leadership Scholars Advisory Committee, Josh Bolton, Alexis Herman. Josh is the chairman and Alexis is the co-chair. The partners at our fellowship presidential centers: Bruce Lindsay, chairman of the board of the Clinton Foundation, Larry Temple, chairman of the board of the LBJ Foundation, and Fred McClure, CEO of the George H.W. Bush Presidential Library Foundation. And last but not least, we are joined by the generous sponsors of this program. Without the support, this program would not be possible. We'd like to thank the three founding sponsors of this program, who we'd like to ask to stand so we can show them our appreciation: the Moody Foundation, represented by Alan Matthews and Jamie Williams; the W.W. Carruth Jr. Foundation, represented by Bobby Lyle, Brent Christopher, and Monica Eggert Smith; and the Miles Foundation, represented by Grant Coates, Sherry Wilson, Jack Burdett, and Jay McCall. We are also joined by our other additional sponsors. Please stand so that we can appropriately recognize you: the Bank of America, the Hirsch Foundation, and Ed Cox. Thank you, thank you. We are grateful for your support of the Presidential Leadership Scholars. Now, to kick off our program, I'd like to welcome to the podium one of our important partners in this initiative, Donna Shalala, President and CEO of the Clinton Foundation.
Thank you very much, Don. Thank you very much, Don. Welcome to this celebration of the inaugural class of the Presidential Leadership Scholars. Mr. President, we're all thrilled to see all of our scholars and their families and friends and all of you who've been part of the success of this first year. I've actually had the pleasure of serving on the advisory committee since the beginning, even before I joined the Clinton Foundation. Coming from the world of higher education, I knew right away that the program would be unlike any other, not only because of the unique curriculum, but because of the sheer talent and diversity and the experience of the scholars themselves. These are people who have already been transformational leaders in their fields. Over the past 6 months, since the journey began at George Washington's Mount Vernon, our scholars have met with governors and ambassadors and cabinet secretaries and presidents. And looking in my crystal ball, I'll tell you right now that there are cabinet secretaries, perhaps presidents, with us tonight, and I don't mean Margaret or Alexis or Josh or Presidents Clinton and Bush. So today we celebrate our scholars and their journey. We celebrate your courage and determination to step up and tackle some of society's greatest challenges. We celebrate the lessons that you've learned and the new friendships that you've made along with your fellow scholars. We celebrate your commitment to make lasting change in the areas that you're passionate about, and we recognize the impact you're already having in these areas. You're developing distribution channels that will ultimately help feed thousands of children in Zambia. You're increasing access to libraries and literacy in deeply impoverished rural communities. You're helping working families save and plan for college. You're working to build hurricane-resistant housing in threatened coastal areas. You're working with Native American tribes to safeguard public lands and protect America's cultural landscape. And you're teaching critical life skills to students who are aging out of foster care in the state of Mississippi. You're making businesses aware of the unique skill sets of young people who serve in our nation's military so they can succeed after their service. The list could go on and on. Every scholar in this room amazes us with the work they are already doing, and their involvement in this program gives us all hope for the future. You'll all be role models of the special kind of leader we need to face our toughest challenges together. To the scholars of the inaugural class, we're grateful for your involvement in the program and inspired by each and every one of you. So on behalf of the partner presidential centers, I thank you for your very good work. We know the best is yet to come. Congratulations. Thank you very much. Now, since we're in Dallas, we thought it was only appropriate to start the program with two mavericks. One of them danced with the stars, and one of them went to the big dance with President Bush. Kevin Sullivan got his start in communications in the sports world with the Dallas Mavericks. The lessons he learned in the NBA's Western Conference ultimately landed him in the West Wing, where he served as President Bush's communications director from 2006 to 2009. Today, he draws on his experiences to advise leaders all across sectors on effective communication. And last month, he released an e-book called Breaking Through: Communications Lessons from the Locker Room, the Boardroom, and the Oval Office. Our other panelist has no problem breaking through, especially when it comes to making his voice heard by the referees from his courtside seats. Mark Cuban, the owner of the Mavericks, is one of America's most successful entrepreneurs, beginning at the age of 12 by selling garbage bags door to door. Along the way, he learned a lot about the kind of perseverance it takes to survive the ups and downs that any leader must navigate. And finally, I think this is an appropriate setting to share that in just 2 weeks, Mark will be adding another job title to his long resume, President of the United States, with his acting role in Sharknado 3. So Mark, if you need some tips, there are a couple of very distinguished gentlemen here who would be willing to share some advice. Please welcome Kevin Sullivan and Mark Cuban.
Thank you. That's awesome. Thank you so much. That's awesome. Thank you very much. Oh, that's funny.
Well, everybody, that was a great introduction from Secretary Shalala. But just to show you how far Mark really has come, take a look at this photo from his early days in Dallas. What was that, about 1982 or 83?
Yeah, 83,
and at that moment, Mark, you know, getting involved with computers, personal computers for the first time, you see the American dream taking hold right there, about ready to.
Wait, do you see the thing in the back that says poverty sucks?
So you're a guy who's, I've seen you quoted as saying, it's in the doing, not the dreaming.
Exactly.
But what is the state of the American dream today?
American dream is alive and well. Does anybody here watch Shark Tank? Yeah. It's a great show, and the fascinating thing about the show on Friday nights is that it's the number one show watched by families together across all of television. Literally, it used to be people wanted to come up and talk to me about basketball. Now I have 8, 10, 20, 80-year-olds telling me about their ideas and telling me about their companies. You know, it's a new age lemonade stand, and I don't think there's any question that with American ingenuity, the education, the type of people we have here, that this is just the best is yet to come. I think some of us get the sense that, we're down, or that's so far from the truth. I'm just seeing more and more amazing businesses, more and more amazing ideas every single day, and you know, I couldn't be more excited about the American dream.
You have to go to Silicon Valley or New York City?
No, heck no. I mean, yeah, I'll tell you this. Hopefully nobody's, there's no media or anybody from Silicon Valley, I'm sure, here. Silicon Valley is like a lot like Hollywood used to be. You know, they're looking over your shoulder for the next big star, the next big deal in Silicon Valley. You come to Dallas, you come to Austin, and you get people who come to work. The university system here is amazing. Whether it's UTD, UT Austin, the school SMU, there's just so many amazing schools where we hire locally. I mean, it's less expensive, but they're just as smart and they're just as driven, and there's just as many businesses being created here. So while I'm not here to say that it's the next Silicon Valley, I'm here to say that Texas is the most amazing state when it comes to not just development talent, but to creating new companies.
Now, the sports fans among us, and I know there's a bunch here, know that you had kind of a tough night last night. With,
So this week on Shark Tank.
Without rehashing all the details of the DeAndre Jordan commitment.
Oh, yeah, just say his name, okay.
From a leadership standpoint, when you have a setback, when you have a tough day, what do you say to your people? What do you say to the fans?
The conversations we've had today, that it's over. You know, there's nothing you can do about it. You think for a second, is there anything I can change? You think for another second, what have I learned so I can do it differently next time? And then you move forward and say, what are our options? You know, I'm a big believer you have to re-earn your business every single day. You have to look to see whether or not you need to reinvent your business every day. Because there's someone out, always someone, there's some 12-year-old, 8-year-old going to UT, SMU, all these great things I just talked about, this great talent, and they're out there trying to kick your butt. Right, and if I'm going to stay ahead, whether it's the NBA or any of my companies, I have to keep on moving forward, and that's the way it is with the Mavericks. You know, we have this big tall German who's pretty good, and he's still around, and we signed Wes Matthews. So I think, you know, we've been fortunate to this point in my 15 years there, and I think we've got great leadership, a great team, and we're going to keep on moving forward.
Presidents make a lot of decisions, obviously, a lot of tough decisions, and our scholars have had the privilege of, you know, going to the Clinton Library, for example, and studying tough decisions President Clinton made. I know they studied the landmark welfare reform legislation that he led. You know, and there were people among your own advisors, President Clinton, that didn't think maybe you should go the way you were going or your party. President Bush, same way, a lot of tough decisions I had the privilege of witnessing up close and personal, often with utter disregard for his personal popularity. He did what was based on his principles that he brought from here in Texas to D.C. How do you handle those really, really tough decisions, especially if you're getting conflicting kinds of advice?
I try to be very self-aware. I try to know what I'm good at and what I'm bad at. I try to know, I try to have smart people around me all the time. And I cross my fingers, you know? there's just some decisions that, you know, you just have to trust yourself. Let me also add, preparation is everything. You know, people have always said, oh, you're such a huge risk taker. I never take risks. You know, any business I've ever started, I've always felt like I've done my homework, I've done the preparation. This isn't a risk. And so, you know, fortunately, I've never been in the same circumstances as our two presidents, and I couldn't even imagine the stress. But in my little world, I just try to be prepared, have great people around me, and, you know, be prepared, make the best decision I can, and hope for the best.
And in that preparation as a way to manage the risk, what kind of things do you do to be prepared?
I read everything I can get my hands on. I talk to as many smart people as I can. I like to, you know, someone once said you have to test your whole card. You know, a lot of times we think we know something, and sometimes success can be your worst enemy because you think you're smarter than you are. And so, you know, even though I feel confident about something, I feel good about something, I'm always like, okay, am I sure that's an ace, or does that change to a jack? So I want to talk to smart people always and check my whole card.
In terms of your team of advisors, I know you're not a big hierarchy guy. Right, you like a flat structure. Would that be a recommendation to make to our scholars as they go forth?
Well, everybody's different, but, you know, in today's day and age, there's so many communication mediums, you know, that you've got to figure out, A, as the leader, what your vision is, B, how you can take those people around you and put them in a position to succeed, and C, really understand how each of them needs to be communicated with, because it's not all one size fits all. We're so used to seeing everybody, you know, not just millennials, but everybody with their head down in their phones. And I tend to try to do everything via email as much as I can. You know, send me a weekly update, bad news first. But when I get that bad news, that's when I have to reach out and go face to face, you know, and be there to help people. But you've always got to be in a position where it's not about you, it's about putting people in a position to achieve your goals, because if you help them and have a vision for them of how to be successful, then that's going to dovetail with the organization. And when that point comes, if it doesn't, where you go your separate ways, there's mutual respect, and that ends up being a contact or somebody for you to network with.
As Secretary Evans pointed out, our scholars are from a really diverse set of backgrounds.
And congratulations to all the graduates.
Private sector, NGOs, government, military, nonprofit, you name it. But the one thing they have in common is that they're going to have to pitch and they're going to have to present their ideas. We've got a clip from Shark Tank to play. This is what Mark says is his favorite pitch that he ever got on Shark Tank. So let's play it. So what about Laney's pitch? What about Laney's pitch was spot on that made you want to?
Everything. I mean, she's a high school student that dropped out of high school to work on her business. I think she had to go outside and raise capital. She didn't say, well, let me ask somebody. She didn't say, well, you know, I was dependent on so-and-so. She just took everything she had to accomplish head on. And she was amazing. I mean, and so we're still partners now. And as a little aside, after this aired, about 6 months later, after we did the deal, she gives me a call, you know, and we corresponded, so I knew business was good. She goes, Mark, I have a problem. Mind you, this is, I think, she's 19 at the time. I have $1 million in the bank. I don't know what to do. I said, you celebrate first, you know. That's a high school student. If a high school student can be prepared to walk onto the carpet of Shark Tank in front of more than 10 million people and guys like us, particularly Kevin, Mr. Wonderful, how can you not be able to be prepared and walk into any situation? Seriously. I mean, she was prepared, and she knew her stuff so cold, she didn't flinch. That's why she wasn't nervous. You know, you're not going to get nervous if I ask you your name and address and phone number, because you just know. If you know your project, if you know your business that well, you're not going to be nervous. And you're going to be able to just be yourself when you make your presentation. You're going to be able to show your leadership qualities. You're going to be able to show your vision, just like Lainey did.
Yeah, and I would encourage you, if you're interested, to watch the whole clip, because she got a lot of questions, and she never wilted under the pressure. We have a question from one of our scholars, Terry Hasdorf. She's the VP of Convoy of Hope, which is all about empowering women. She's got a great project to empower women with basic business skills. But Terry asks for your advice on better partnering with the private sector as somebody who is in that nonprofit world.
I mean, it's a numbers game. You know, there's no business, small or large, that hasn't heard from a social enterprise or doesn't have its own social conscience. And so you're not going to be in a situation where you're the only person knocking on that door or picking up the phone and talking to them or sending them an email. And so you have to recognize that it truly is a numbers game, and every no gets you closer to a yes. But there will come a time when that, just when you think, oh my goodness, they're going to say no, bam, that's when they say yes. And so whether it's women's issues, no matter what it is, look, if it were easy, it'd already be done. It's not supposed to be easy. It's supposed to be hard. There isn't a template that everybody follows for success. You have to put in the energy to be prepared. And if you really care about what you're trying to accomplish, it's not work. You know, I always have a test. If you dream about it, it's right for you. You know, if you wake up and you're taking notes about your business because that's what you were thinking about, it's right for you. And if you have that much commitment and conviction, who cares if it's one more door you have to call on? Who cares if there's one more company you have to speak to? That's what it takes.
So as an entrepreneur and an investor, what are the biggest impediments today and obstacles that you could run into for either starting or growing a business?
Yourself. You know, companies don't fail for lack of money 99% of the time. They fail for lack of brains and effort. You know what the one thing in business that you can control? And I say this to athletes as well. The one thing in business that you can control, your effort. That's the one thing no one can ever take away from you and that you can control. And so that is always, you know, that's the key. And if you learn and you're always learning, you're always looking to improve and you're always looking to re-earn your business and you're putting in the effort, you got a shot and you can be successful.
Now you had another kind of famous Mark Cuban Shark Tank contestant, Scotty Vest was the name of the company,
right?
And he had a patent. He was basically just trying to license a patent. But why don't you tell that story? Because that pushed your buttons pretty good. Is another one to check out.
Yeah. So there's a gentleman who came on the show, and he had a coat, an outdoors coat, and his secret sauce was he had a lot of pockets. But in his pockets, he had a patent so that if you ran a wire up your sleeve using headphones and connected them to something to listen, that's what he had patented. And I was like, how do you patent that? And no lie, when I was a kid growing up in Pittsburgh, I would listen to the Pittsburgh Pirates, and I'd have a transistor radio that I'd put, like, hide from my teacher, and I'd listen to the Pirates when they were in the playoffs, and I'd run one, you know, those old school headphone things that you could listen that had a wire, and I'd run it up my shirt, and, you know, when I put it in my ear and kind of lean this way so the teacher wouldn't see me. And I'm like, how the heck do you patent that? And so I went off on him, and it created this big uproar and led to me funding a chair called at the Electronic Freedom Foundation, the EFF, called the Mark Cuban Chair to Eliminate Stupid Patents. And so I gave him money, and they're like, we can't name it that. People are going to think it's crazy. I'm like, that's exactly the point, right? Because there's so many patents, and to me, that's an inhibitor to progress. You know, I'm a clean room fan. If you go back to the 80s of computers, when there was Compaq and IBM, and if you did it in the clean room and independently created it, then you could run with it and create your company. And that led a big way to the start of the internet and the computer boom. But now it's a race to the patent office to try to get. I literally tell another quick story. back in 2006, I have a movie distribution company called Magnolia and a theater company called Landmark. It's the Magnolia here in town, the Inwood. And so we decided we needed to change things up. So we wanted to put movies on TV, on DVD, and online before they're in theaters. Just natural course of business. We got sued because somebody patented that after reading and what I had done. They created a patent and literally referenced what I was doing in the patent and then turned around and sued me for it. So I gave a little bit more money to that foundation. And but I think there's things that we need to do because it does inhibit progress.
Another scholar question. Shelley Cryan asks, and she's another slacker like most of the scholars, project manager at Charity Logic Corporation, software for nonprofits. Uh-huh. But she's also, her project is teaching teenage girls in the Gambia how to start photography businesses so they can earn money to stay in school. So
oh, wow.
Pretty amazing.
That's very cool.
She asks, on Shark Tank, you measure ROI, uh-huh. You know, when making a decision. But how do you measure the social good or the way an idea would help a community when deciding on an idea?
With ROH, return on your heart. You know, what else is there? You know, it's not easy to get people to believe, you know, but you're not there to, there's no I, that's really, it's about heart. And so thank you. You know, it's something special and, you know, I don't know what else I can say about it.
You know, there's an element of storytelling. We saw that Lainey made her product personal, how it could specifically help you.
Uh-huh.
And I think that's the ROH is making it personal. Another question from a scholar, Yasmin Bhatia, CEO of Uplift Education, a charter school network here in Dallas-Fort Worth, whose project is developing fellowships for North Texas urban principals.
Cool.
Very cool. She asks, how do you find the time, as busy you are, just the mental space to think? You're a big idea guy. How do you think?
Because there's not a lot of mental space there, so it rolls over very quickly. I don't know, I just try to, I find things, you know, everything is a progression. You know, I forget the exact Steve Jobs quote, right, where, you know, everything is a remix, that's what it was, right?
Right?
And so the more you consume, the more you learn, the more you're open to learning, the more ideas you have. And to me, I'll put it a different way. The most competitive, and I've said this to Dirk and other Mavs players, the most competitive sport there is business. And I'll add nonprofits as well, and it's not comparable. It's incredibly competitive because you're competing 24/7, by 365, by forever. And there's always someone trying to kick your butt. And I am so competitive, I love the competition of it. You know, my basketball game isn't so good anymore. Unless you ask me, then I'll tell you otherwise. But the business is a sport. Running a nonprofit in a lot of respects is a sport, and it's nonstop. And so that's what gets me excited. That's what keeps me going. That's why I love to continue to learn.
I heard you say in a radio interview that long ago that your biggest fear was that your kids would grow up to be jerks.
Yeah, my wife is right here, and that's like, give
so
it a look.
So there's no chance that that's going to happen with Tiffany
yeah,
at
I know.
The helm.
Yeah, but there's this other guy at the house, you know.
What did you mean by that, and talk about how you manage?
I mean, we try to be as normal as possible. You know, yes, we have help, but we don't have butlers. We drive our kids to school. You know, we put our kids to bed, except when there's a Mavs game. We try to, you know, we have help during the day, but at night we try to be by ourselves as much as possible. And we try to just make our kids appreciate. It's hard to explain, but I want them to have a little bit of struggle, but not too much. But I want them to learn. I want them to appreciate. I don't want them to feel entitled. And so, you know, Tiff and I try to do as best we can to always make them feel appreciative of everything around them. And some of you got to meet Jakey, and you know, hopefully he came across as somebody who is going to grow up to be that way. So, yeah.
You read 3 hours a day. Is this
give
is still
take, yeah.
Every day, give or take?
Yeah, you can ask Tiff, get off of there. What are you doing? Stop.
You read, you know, on your tablet, on...
Everything from my phone, tablet, newspapers. So I get the Financial Times, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Dallas Morning News delivered. I could read them online, but A, I feel sorry for newspapers, and B... And B, you just want something different. You don't want to always be staring at a screen. But I don't get to read books as much as I'd like to, so it's more content-driven online relative to all the different topics I'm interested in.
Well, Will Simpson, who's with the Mississippi Department of Human Services, and his project is teaching critical life skills to aging out foster kids. So another great, very impressive, ambitious projects. He says, what should the scholars be reading?
Oh my goodness, I mean, that's not a fair question. Read what you love. I mean, read what gets you excited. There are no business books that's it, that's all you need to know. There's no one class, there's no one thing that you can do that's just a shortcut. You know, I was talking to him earlier, I mean, experience is literally the best teacher, but as you dip your toes or as you move forward with your endeavors and your challenges, you recognize the things that are going to be a little bit more difficult. And when I run into those difficulty factors, that's when the antennas go up, and that's where I go out and say, okay, what can I read? Some people are more about, what will my mentor tell me? I'm more, okay, I need to be able to consume it. I need to be able to, you know, really internalize it and move forward. And so in terms of what to read, whenever you run into a roadblock or whatever you see related to your vision, you know, I love to read biographies, people who have done things before, like our presidents here. They're just so much that you can learn. I'll put it another way. I still walk through, even though there's not a lot of magazines left, I'll walk through bookstores, look for a magazine, because if I find one idea, one thought, it's worth the $5 or $10. Mm-hmm. If I find one book with one idea, it's worth the $20. And so you never know when that next idea that just the light bulb goes on. And so you've got to keep that mind open and look to find it.
Now, one idea that you've had in the last year or so, a couple of years, is cyber dust.
Uh-huh.
Now, for those of you who don't know, and I recommend it, it's an app, and you can text, and your text disappears on a 24-second shot clock. Now, I know we all know some people, especially in Washington, who could have benefited from disappearing social media content. But talk about the way, you know, we live our lives so publicly now.
Right.
As
well, 2 points there. One, with social media now, when we get on social media, we think, okay, our friends, our family, but then it kind of has spread, right? It gets bigger, and our networks extend, and you get to a point then, all of a sudden, where your network, your social media network, says more about you than you realize, and it may say things about you that you don't realize. You know, if you go back and look at your Facebook's friends of friends, in this day and age, unfortunately, people will hold you accountable for that. And so I always make sure I go back and there's an app called Expire, X-P-I-R-E, that allows me to go back and delete all my tweets. Because there's no good reason. It's like fashion, right? People don't need to see that, what you wrote 2 years ago. There's just no point. And then on the app Cyberdust, you know, when you think about messaging in this day and age, the minute you hit send on a text, on an email, iMessage, whatever it may be, the minute you hit send, you don't own it anymore. And if you're a visible person, someone who has a lot of responsibility, there's a good chance that the person you're sending it to is keeping it. Now think about the consequences. You don't own it, they own it, but you still have responsibility for it. It's scary, you know? And over the course of time, like fashion, many of us have thousands of texts that we've sent that might have seemed like the coolest, yeah, no problem at all. It's all like the old Seinfeld episode where they're, oh, schmoopy, you know? Yes. Just old acquaintances, old business things. I mean, while Sony owns the show Shark Tank, and so while the Sony hack was going on, I made sure my negotiations for my contract were done on Cyberdust, not knowing that this hack was going on. Everything else came out, people lost their jobs, every single employee of Sony was frantic and scared to wits, but we were safe. And so it's an app called Cyberdust, C-Y-B-E-R-D-U-S-T. It's in the App Store. And if you want to reach me, my username is M. Cuban.
There you go.
But I'm not pitching anything.
Always selling. Well, that's
always selling,
always
right?
Always selling, right?
Always be selling.
Now, we've got a room full of media here.
Uh-oh.
As well. Now, and you're, so you talked about social media. You like to conduct interviews when you can via email.
Yes, sir.
So why is that?
Reporters, there's reporters and there's opinion, right? Opinion, they are who they are. But in reporting, I learned early on that what you say in an email may not be, the full transcript may not be used, and that's their job to try to create a story. And so having a full email transcript of any email interview I've done has given me the chance to post on my blog the real story. Now I try to do more of this via CyberDust, so it's like, CyberDust is like a face-to-face conversation, so it's a digital version of that. But historically, if it's going to be a longer interview, I'll use email, knowing that on my blog I have a way to post it to protect myself, because you just don't know, how media is going to take anything that you tell them.
So it's your way of controlling them.
Yeah, and particularly in social endeavors, right, all it takes is one misstep or one misstatement of an interview, and you're toast. And if all you did was sit down and, they have a tape of it, well, this is what I thought you meant. And it's not that email can't have nuance, but at least you have the ability to have all that context.
What advice do you have for our scholars when they are asked by younger people in their organizations to mentor them? What's the best thing you can tell a young person?
Be honest about your time. It just sounds so good to be a mentor and have a mentor. I was never a big mentor person. I was more like, get my hands dirty. But, it's hard to mentor 20 people or 30 people. Be honest. And as a young person looking for a mentor, realize they don't live their lives to mentor you. that it's a resource that is very, very valuable. And make sure that it's a resource of last resort. And then, look, there's also friendships and there's relationships that go with it that are amazing. But I think you have to really, really understand as a mentor what the expectations are of who you're trying, the mentee, and vice versa.
Secretary Spellings and I attended an event at Microsoft years ago when I'm still working for. If you've ever worked for once, you work for permanently. But Bill Gates was asked a question about his schedule. How do you control your schedule? And he said he had Steve Ballmer check it and cross-check it and not commit to things so far up as if you're not going to be busy then. What advice do you have about the way you commit your time and build your schedule?
I have somebody who runs my life, who does my schedule, but I'm the same way. I don't commit so far in advance simply because I still think the best is yet to come. I'm still excited about all the opportunities that are in front of me, and so I don't want to preclude myself from something. And like a lot of people here, we get asked to speak every minute of every day. I just, like I said, I'm such a strong believer in the American dream. I'm such a strong believer that today is the youngest you'll ever be. You have to live like it. And I'm such a strong believer that the best is yet to come for me. And if that's the case, and my children, if that's the case, then I'm not going to lock anything in. My schedule's TBD, and hopefully will be for a long time.
We have 30 seconds. If you thought the last question was tough, many of our scholars asked, what is the next big thing?
The next big thing is a big center for the Mavs. No, I would say personalized medicine. Our bodies basically are equations, and as computers get faster and faster and faster, we begin to understand more about them. We understand more variables. Let's put this, my son Jake, who's 5, maybe not when he's 25, maybe it'll be when he has kids, but the concept of walking into a drugstore and buying over-the-counter medicine that has a warning that says you might be the one unlucky schmuck that dies from this will seem barbaric. Everything that we take for our grandkids, their kids, will be personalized. There's a company, Theranos, you take one little tweak of blood and they'll do a complete analysis in seconds. And so as we learn more and more about this wondrous body that we have and all the variables that are in it, the proteins, everything, we'll be able to more certainly determine what it takes to cure us. Now that's gonna create a whole new set of questions, that are bigger than me. But yeah, personalized medicine is definitely something that's going to change the world. And all these discussions we have about the cost of medicine, and everybody trying to predict 10 years out, they're wrong. So, and there's going to be people like you out there that are going to invent even better ways. So there's exciting things to come.
Well, thank you again to the Moody Foundation, and thanks to Mark Cuban. Thank you. And the and now to help your understanding of exactly what the Presidential Leadership Scholars Program is, we have a video for you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
You come into a program like Presidential Leadership Scholars, and you meet your classmates, and you meet the people who have served administrations, and you learn about the different areas of concern and the different issues they're working on, and the fact that they're motivated and talented, and you realize that there's a network of professionals with a mind toward doing civic good throughout the country, and it just renews your hope and your faith in what this country can be and where it's headed.
This is a one-of-a-kind program that brings four presidential centers together. This is a program that brings together really the best elements of what the presidents can offer to young leaders. The assets of the presidential libraries, the various artifacts. It also brings the people that were associated with those presidents, those administrations, and allows the scholars to interact with them very personally in very intimate settings and use those lessons for their own leadership development.
The most important thing that I've learned through the Presidential Leadership Scholarship is that leadership is truly a contact sport. And it requires a person to really dig deep within first himself and then to reach out to others to build a consensus and a plan for success.
The PLS program, it absolutely has made me a better leader. It has given me access to individuals, former presidents, cabinet officials, and you learn some key insights into why they made decisions, the decisions that they did.
We weren't interested in gathering together a group of people who were just interested in learning more about leadership. We wanted to recruit people into the program who were already active in their communities and trying to make a difference. And that's what these projects represent. These projects represent the passion and the commitment of our scholars to making their communities a better place.
My project involves providing federal judges the opportunity to learn about the work of the national security apparatus and the intelligence agencies. The idea was that the courts have seen more and more of these cases over the last decade or so. So federal judges are now confronting these issues at a time when not many federal judges have a lot of experience in this area.
We have to balance the security needs of the United States against our liberty requirements under our Constitution. And I think most judges appreciate what those liberty interests are, but very few of us have a good appreciation or understanding what the intelligence needs are.
So my personal leadership project is called Captain's Academy. And Captain's Academy will bring the boys and girls captains of the high schools within Austin to the University of Texas for 3 half-day leadership training sessions. And really the genesis for this idea was born through the Presidential Leadership Scholars Program. I saw how my own leadership style was enhanced after the first session and the second session. And so I really understood that there is a need for this type of leadership training at the high school level.
When you have your captains from these various sports coming together, coming back with a positive message, taking that positive message to the campus, I think that you're going to start to see a change in the culture at that campus.
What we do at Team Rubicon Global is taking the military veterans of very different countries, bringing them together and deploying them into the field in response to natural disasters. PLS has helped me better understand how values drive mission, which drives strategy and tactics. We're building out a global veteran service organization, so you can imagine the amount of planning that is going into building these new Team Rubicons around the world. PLS has been very important in that planning process.
I have seen a man with real passion and drive begin to understand how to manage and, dare I say, manipulate in order to get the right outcome for the collective good.
I had one goal at PLS, that was by the end of the program that Team Rubicon UK had conducted one operation, and I'm proud to report that they deployed to Nepal in response to the earthquake.
We worked really hard to put together a group of scholars that was as diverse as possible, and diverse in terms of of their life experience, their professional experience, their political perspective, and we succeeded in doing that. The great thing about bringing them together for the first time in Mount Vernon was to see how openly grateful they were for being in this group, for being able to meet people who were so different from them, and to know they were going to be in this program for the next 6 months with them. And over time, very quickly, what they realized is there was a lot to learn, not just from the faculty we were bringing in, but there's a lot to learn from each other.
The thing that I think is so important about it is that they provoke each other, they learn from each other, they challenge each other, they support each other, and it's just been a tremendous opportunity for each of them. I know that they will do great things going forward for many, many years, and I expect to see them in public life and making a difference in their communities across the country and across the world.
PLS has made a lasting impact on my life because it's introduced me to a broad set of leaders from a very diverse backgrounds, both from the for-profit and non-profit communities. And I think these people are friends for life.
And from my other 59 scholars and hearing their experiences in leading organizations, both in the nonprofit and the public sectors, and even the for-profit sector, I've gleaned an invaluable set of lessons that will guide my leadership strategy moving forward.
I feel, having been given the opportunity, I now have a responsibility to go out and lead and to make a positive change and to execute my project. And then to turn around and say to my classmates and my current scholars and future scholars, how can I help you? What can I do to make your project easier? What can I do to move your initiative forward?
Please welcome Presidential Leadership Scholar Jake Harriman.
It is such a humbling honor to be able to represent the inaugural class of PLS. I want to thank President Clinton, President Bush, representatives from the four presidential libraries, the senior leadership of the Clinton Foundation and the Bush Center, our generous donors who made all of this possible for our scholars. And last but not least, I want to thank our staff and faculty of the PLS program. You guys put countless hours into this program, and it was a smashing success. So thank you guys so much for your time and effort. PLS has been a transformative experience for all of us scholars. We've all gained valuable lessons from all the presidents that were a part of the program. And after each module, I took to posting what I thought were top 10 takeaways from each of the modules on my blog. And I thought I'd share a few of those with you here today, that the ones that impacted my own leadership most effectively. First of all, President Clinton taught us that as a leader, you always have to be looking down the road. A leader has to keep his eyes up and looking out to anticipate challenges, to shape the battlefield, to ensure that when the team arrives, they're successful. President Bush taught us that a firm foundation is absolutely critical. A leader has to establish a core set of values and principles that simply will not change, and then build a decision-making process on that bedrock. We learned from the elder President Bush that if you want to build trust, you have to invest in personal relationships. That when the chips are down and your team is under fire, the relationships and the trust that you build will enable you to come together, hunker down, and fight through to victory. But I think the best lesson that I learned, the most important lesson that I learned at PLS, was that if I ever want to make a fashion statement at the next White House event, I need to have Kevin Hooks on speed dial, and he will make me look my best. To the presidents and your teams, I have been so inspired by your vision to create this program. You know, servant leadership is about leading by example. It's about getting in the trenches with your people, getting dirt under your fingernails, and demonstrating to your team what is actually possible. And I've seen you both do this. You both understand the ugly, divisive challenges that our leaders in America face today. And I witnessed you and your teams from the top on down, stepping forward, stepping across the aisle, greeting and embracing the other side in an effort to heal the partisan rift that is tearing our nation apart today. And I want to thank you both so much for your strong, bold leadership in this way. It has meant the world to me, it has meant the world to the scholars, and it will mean the world to the country as we approach an election year. Thank you very much for that. And now I'd like to turn my attention to my fellow scholars, my teammates, my new family. When I first heard that I was going to be speaking today, I instantly thought of you guys, and I was really scared. I was terrified. I was terrified that I was going to let you down, that I wasn't going to be able to make you proud enough of the progress that we have made over the last 6 months. And, you know, as I thought about that, I reached out to a few of you in my anxiety for advice. And the advice I got back was, you know what, just be authentic. Be yourself. I think Carlos said, be you. So in the spirit of that advice, I want to offer you the following remarks. And just remember that you asked for it. As many of you know, I had the opportunity and privilege to serve our great nation on the front lines of combat as a Marine in 3rd Battalion, 1st Marines, and then 1st Force Reconnaissance Company. And I often get asked by my friends and family why I chose to fight. You know, war is a terrible thing. It's one of the worst things that we can do to each other as human beings. And stories get written in combat that you simply cannot unwrite. But there is evil in this world, evil that fuels the inequality and injustice and oppression of freedom around the world, evil that makes our armed forces absolutely critical and a necessity. You see, it was the horrors of combat that shaped and molded me into the man and the leader that you see before you today. And so when I reflect back on that question about why I chose to fight, the answer is pretty simple. At a very basic level, first, I chose to fight for that Marine on my right and the Marine on my left to make sure that I could get my brothers home safely to the families who I knew were waiting for them at home. But second, and perhaps more deeply, I chose to fight for the idea that is America. The idea that is America. A nation that stands for the freedom of human rights and lasting, meaningful choices for everyone, everywhere. Our nation stands at a real crossroads today. There are daunting challenges, both internationally and domestically. ISIS and Al-Qaeda grow daily in number and strength by preying on the desperation and instability of impoverished nations that fuel their movements. Here at home, our leaders are blindly divided across deep-seated party lines. And the people of our nation live in fear. Fear and sometimes blind hatred of each other. We have lost sight of what ties us together. We have lost sight about what makes us Americans. But as I look out in this audience today, as I look at you guys, I see hope. Each of you is in that seat today for a reason. You were chosen. Each of us are risk takers. You know, and as such, we are uniquely equipped to leverage the lessons from this PLS program better than others to truly create disruptive change in our nation and our world. Not just change for change's sake, but change for the sake of a nation as it was always meant to be. We all came to this program for different reasons. Some of us for a network, some of us for professional development, some of us for strategic advice for a project or an organization. But what all of us found was inspiration and a calling. Your selection as a presidential leadership scholar is a strong call of duty. And as I look out at you today, I see the future leaders of our country in academia, in education, in state and local governments, in Congress, and yes, perhaps one day, even the President of the United States. And I want to encourage you today, do not let this be just another Leadership Fellows program. Don't be looking around to find out who's the next great leader to get behind. What's the next great movement to get behind? You are that leader, and you're leading that movement. And it's time for us to step out of the rank and file and rediscover the idea that is America. As Teddy Roosevelt so famously said, it's not the critic that counts. It's not the man who points out where the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds should have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who's actually in the arena, whose face is marred with dust and sweat and blood. But what does that mean for us? That's a bold challenge. What does that mean for us as PLS scholars? After Hurricane Katrina, Nirav Kingsland transformed the structure of public education in New Orleans. And now he's scaling that model to reinvent public education across the country. Diana Mao is disrupting a $99 billion global human trafficking industry by providing training and job opportunities for survivors and the most vulnerable, while simultaneously engaging large brands to decrease child and forced labor in the supply chains. Casey Gerald is mobilizing the next generation of Americans to come together and unleash their entrepreneurial spirit to create jobs, change lives, and repair the social fabric in our country today. That's three. There are 56 more amazing catalytic ways to step into the arena. You're sitting in those seats right there. But we have to do it. Every generation in this country will leave its own indelible mark on the face of this great nation. And now it's our turn. But it's going to take a lot of sacrifice. The road is going to be hard. There's going to be daunting challenges. But I can assure you that the path is well known and well worn by many of the courageous leaders who are sitting here with us today, who stand ready to support us. Don't shy away from your call of duty. Because in the end, as Roosevelt says, at best, we will know the triumph of high achievement. And at worst, if we fail, well, at least we fail while daring greatly, so that our place will never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat. The time has come for us. I challenge you to step with me now into the arena, and let's restore the idea that is America, to bring freedom and hope once again to our nation and to the world. Thank you. And it's now my privilege to invite to the stage three leaders who have certainly stepped into the arena on a global scale. Three leaders whom I have the utmost respect and admiration for. First, Margaret Spellings, the president of the George W. Bush Presidential Center. And she will be moderating the conversation. And then two leaders whom I had the privilege of serving under as my commanders in chief. Two leaders from whom we've all learned valuable lessons about leadership and life. It is my honor to introduce to you today the 42nd and 43rd Presidents of the United States, President William J. Clinton and President George W. Bush.
You know, I know two people are glad he's not running for president.
Hey, that was my line. All right.
I know two who are glad he didn't run earlier.
Exactly.
Thank you both for being here. I thought you were going to be the highlight of the program, but no. It's debatable at this point.
I didn't think anybody could top Mark Cuban.
Yeah.
He was great. Thank you for being here, Mark. Really appreciate it.
President Clinton, welcome back to the Bush Center. We're thrilled you're here. And just a quick personal privilege, it has been a delight to get to work with your team, especially Bruce Lindsay and Valerie Alexander, Stephanie Street, and Mike Hemphill. We love each other. We've had a blast working together.
Well, I think everybody knows that you were the spark plug that made this happen, and we were glad to be asked to help.
That's not why I said it.
And it succeeded beyond my wildest dreams. So thank you very much for giving us a chance to do something that I think is of lasting importance.
Well, and we all echo, obviously, Jake's sentiments. So without further ado, it seems like just yesterday that Josh Bolton was sitting in my place in Washington launching this program together just last September, 10 months ago. And so here we are graduating this awesome class. So let me start by asking the importance of the two of you working together. That particular feature has meant a whole lot to the scholars. And you've both had the opportunity to spend some time with the scholars. What have you thought of them as you've gotten to know them? What's impressed you about them? What surprised you about them? What do you think of this generation of leaders? President Bush?
Well, you know, Mark said something very interesting in that he runs into pessimistic people about the future of the country. And I understand that, I do too. But when you meet these scholars, you can't be pessimistic about the future of the country. These are really fine people who, you know, just inspire hope. Clinton and I are getting a little long in the tooth these days.
This is the 1 month of the year when he's older than me. So speak for yourself.
Yeah, I'm a month longer in the tooth. I guess as you get longer in the tooth, and as society moves on, there's a tendency for some to be pessimistic. And my advice is hang out with the scholars.
President Clinton?
Yeah, I think the one thing that I found particularly interesting about this group, that I liked them when they were admitted, but when I read more about their specific projects and when we were preparing to come here, is that they're diverse in every way. They don't just look different and think different. They have different skills, they have different things. And to think that we have this much talent and this much innovation going into so many different aspects of our national life, I'm like you, I don't get people who are down on our future. I'd rather be America looking ahead for what I think the world will look like in 20 or 30 years. I like our chances. We are younger than every big country but China. If they hadn't changed their one-child policy, we'd have been younger than China in 20 years. And if we get a good immigration reform, which you tried to do and which I hope we'll get, we'll stay young. Either that or we're going to have to encourage that young woman who works for you that I met today to keep having more babies. Because having lost it, I can tell you, youth matters. Youth matters. But I like our chances, and I think everybody who sees, you got to, besides all the other advantages, it's the people that matter. And as long as this is a free country and people are free to debate and free to be creative, and as long as when it really matters, we can come together, and I have to say this, that I almost cried when I saw that picture of the South Carolina legislature yesterday with the Republicans and the Democrats and the African Americans and the white people embracing each other and making that vote and seeing the decisive speech made by a woman who was a direct descendant of Jefferson Davis. Don't tell me that we can't get together across the lines that divide. We just have to keep working at it.
Yeah. So, as you know, these scholars have had an opportunity to study your decisions through this case study approach, as well as those of President H.W. Bush and LBJ. And so take a minute and talk about your decision-making process, President Clinton. How do you know when it's time to decide? These are questions our scholars want to know. And how do you move on and not get totally tied in knots over your decisions?
First of all, I think knowing when it's time to decide is a big deal. You have to know, to answer that question, what all's going on and what kind of decision you're making. That is, if you make a mistake, is it irrevocable? If so, then you maybe ought to take a little more time. But there are a lot of decisions where a decision that's on a scale of 1 to 100, 70% right today is better than a decision that's 100% right 6 months from now when the train has left the station. And so that's what I always ask myself, are the consequences irrevocable? I'll give you one example. Whenever we were getting ready to bomb somebody, sometimes my advisors would say, if you don't do this today, you'll look weak. We'll look so weak. And I always said, can I kill him tomorrow? Now you're laughing, but think about this. I said, because I can't bring him back to life tomorrow. If the answer is yes, I can kill him tomorrow, then we're not weak. So let's debate whether we should do it today. On the other hand, there are those decisions that you literally will paralyze yourself if you don't just go in and make. Because waiting for 6 months so you can get 100% right is foolish. And I think to make the best decisions, you have to have people that know things you don't know, who will tell you what you don't want to hear, and who aren't afraid to debate. And you have to have a sense when the time has come to decide.
President Bush.
Well, he's a lot of wisdom there. But sometimes the circumstance, at least during my presidency, the circumstance made it really imperative you decide. And decide decisively. I guess the thing that dominated my administration was an enemy that wanted to kill again. And therefore, I had to make decisions that protected the homeland. I mean, that was my goal. And some of the decisions that I had to make needed to be made fairly quickly because the enemy, it sadly still exists, doesn't really care about whether a president agonizes over a decision or not. And I think the most important point for the scholars is, and Bill said this, is to know what you don't know and find people who do. In other words, sometimes when you get to be real powerful, the tendency is to say, I must know everything. Otherwise, I wouldn't be so powerful. And you don't. And it's essential that you know yourself first and find people who are capable of fighting through all the trappings of power and I'll give you their good advice. I got a couple here in this room, you, Josh. I mean, people like that I don't think would have served in my administration if they felt their primary job was to make me look good, which was an impossible task to begin with. Jake's talk about, you know, strategy and principle are really important that everybody in the team knows and that the environment is such that the sycophants aren't allowed in. I don't know if that makes any sense, but...
President Bush...
They told me to use some big words.
Used properly.
Yeah.
President Bush...
This is the point where I reach in my back pocket to make sure my billfold's still there. I don't know any big words. I'm just a poor itinerant portrait artist.
Right. President Bush.
Yes.
Okay. So the scholars read your father's book about relationships and building relationships.
Yeah,
over
my
time.
Only question is why didn't they read mine?
They did.
Oh, they did.
They did. Yeah. They did.
Good.
They did.
Thank you.
And but it talked about obviously his letter writing and his development of relationships over many years, not just when you need something, but
right. You
know, over time. And so talk about what they should learn from your dad and how you all have developed relationships.
Well, one of the most remarkable relationships that I described in the book called 41, which a lot of copies in the store over here, was a relationship that Bill had with my dad. So losing an election isn't fun. I've lost one, you've lost one. He lost one to him. And yet they ended up having a friendship. So you got to ask the question, how does it happen? How do, like, what people think are bitter enemies in the political arena able to put aside victory and defeat? I think in Dad's case, that winning and losing an election was not the most central thing in his life. The most central things in his life turned out to be his faith and his family. And therefore, if it's, it makes it much easier to deal with disappointments on the daily occurrences of life. Secondly, it helped a lot that Bill was so gracious. In other words, it's important to be a humble winner. And I find that relationship to be very instructive. That's why I spent a fair amount of time in chapter 7 on it. So one of my favorite stories, for those of you who haven't heard this and didn't read the first book I wrote, was when I introduced Putin to Barney. Now, Barney was our Scottish Terrier, and he dissed him. He basically kind of body language said, "You call that a dog?" And it really, frankly, to the extent that it hurt my feelings, I didn't let him know. Anyway, so a year later, Putin says, "You want to meet my dog?" And I said, "Sure." Outbounds this giant Russian hound. And Putin looks at me and says, "Bigger, stronger, and faster than Barney." Now, you could take umbrage at something like that, but so the point of the story is, I learned a lot about Putin then. Like I said, my dog is bigger than your dog, you know? it's instructive. The lesson is, listen carefully to what others say. Don't prejudge their sentiments, and let them speak. And 41 was a great personal diplomat because he listened to the other person a lot.
Mm-hmm. President Clinton, when you were with the scholars in Little Rock, you had a great discussion with them, and you said that if you don't have respect for your adversary, if you don't believe that the other guy is well-intended, means to do right, then you're not going to get very far with them. What are some of the ways that you've worked to understand the other guy's point of view, the other person's point of view?
Well, I think I said this when we had the opening of the presidential, all these folks. I can't remember the
launch.
Anyway, my family raised me to believe in a storytelling culture, and I couldn't tell one until I could listen to one and reiterate it. And one of the most enduring stories of my childhood was my eighth grade science teacher, who was not an attractive man, telling me that none of us would ever remember anything we had in eighth grade science. So we should remember this. He said, "Every day I get up and I start the day in the bathroom throwing water in my face, putting shaving cream on, shaving, then washing my face off. And I look in the mirror and say, 'Vernon, you're beautiful.'" And he said, "You just remember this. Everybody wants to believe they're beautiful. If you remember that, it'll take you a long way." And I have tried to remember that. And I remember this one other quick example. The loss of trust is paralyzing this country and this world. 20 years ago this fall, Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin was murdered by a fellow Israeli because he presided over the first big handover of land in the West Bank to the Palestinians. The whole thing was nearly screwed up because one of the maps they were signing said a road belonged to Israel that Arafat thought was his. I told him to go in and fix it, figure out what the truth was, but we were late and the World Press Corps was waiting. So they walked out, Rabin says, "He's right, that road should be his." It was a road to Jericho, around a Christian monument. I said, "Well, what are we gonna do?" He said, "Arafat says we're gonna go sign the maps." I said, now you realize we signed these maps, they belong to Israel as a matter of international law. And Arafat, for all of his faults, and he had a lot of them, looked at me and he said, oh, Rabin's word is worth more than any written contract. He said, yeah, I'm going to give him the road tomorrow. And he did. Now, you cannot imagine somebody doing that today over there, can you? I'm telling you, if people trust each other, everything else is possible. And if they don't, I don't care how good an argument they make, how many people they listen to, it's very hard to get anything done.
So for both of you, in Austin, the LBJ Library did a terrific job of hosting them, and the scholars had the opportunity to learn about communication. Of course, LBJ is well known for his physical presence and his relentless style and so forth. And they listened to the tapes of him talking in real time to Martin Luther King and Everett Dirksen and so forth as he negotiated the Voting Rights Act. So talk about your persuasive style and how you adapt it to a particular situation. When to push, when to cajole, when to hold, when to fold. President Clinton.
Well, sometimes, first of all, you got to know who you're trying to persuade. When I was working with other world leaders, I never, consciously at least, made an argument for what was in America's interest. I always told them why what I thought was right for America was in their interest. In other words, these other people didn't hire on to help you or this country. They hired on to help their people and their perception of it. So I think whenever you're arguing with someone else, it proves you listen to them. You have to listen very carefully to other people. But if you should always make the argument in terms of their interest. When I was trying to persuade in Congress, I tried to figure out if there was anything they wanted that I could in good conscience give them. And if there was, I did it. And sometimes we were right at the border of the definition of in good conscience. There's a reason Mark Twain said the two things people should never watch being made are sausage and laws. And I think it was a mistake to get rid of these earmarks because it's harder for the president to argue. And I think sometimes Congress knows better than federal employees what the best way to spend money is in their districts. So anyway, I think it's different for different conditions. But first, you got to be able to listen to who it is you're trying to persuade and see if you can respond on the merits or changing the subject.
President Bush, I've watched you do this for years.
Yeah.
And you're real good at it.
Thank you.
Talk about
why?
How you persuade people. you tell me why you think so.
I think that it is important to earn capital to spend capital. In other words, I can remember on the tax cut plan, trying to get out of the recession, that I would go to a state where I had done well politically, and Ben Nelson, he was a Democrat senator in Nebraska, frankly an endangered species. And so I went to his state, flew him down on Air Force One, as I recall, and did a tax cut event with him there, and trying to get his vote, and we got it. I think that, my only point is you can earn capital all kinds of ways in the political process. There are some people that are just not going to vote with you at all. Mm. And so it's frankly important not to waste your time. On the other hand, I do think it's important to create an environment amongst even those who are less likely to vote for you to of cordiality. I mean, one of the most unique relationships I had was with Ted Kennedy. A lot of it had to do with you. And there were some issues we could agree on, a lot of issues we didn't agree on, but I try to convince him on what issues. In other words, you gotta know the people you're dealing with. Mm-hmm. Republicans were generally easier for me to work with, particularly when I was riding high. A little more of a challenge after 06. But it turns out that if you're polite, kind, considerate to people, they're a lot more likely to listen to you.
Give an example of that on the international stage, that sort of persuasive, and we're watching the debate, the negotiations on the deal right now. But talk about use of that persuasive style in an international setting.
Well, by the time the issues get up to the president, there's been a lot of persuasiveness going on. Mm-hmm. That's what you have a Secretary of State for and a National Security Council for. And generally, the issues are pretty cooked by the time you get there. And always, well, just a lesson, and I know Cuba knows this, never negotiate principal to advisor unless you're the one providing the advisor. In other words, you always want somebody playing their hand, and the person has to go back and say, well, I got to make sure Bush okays it. And so I never got myself in a position where the person said, well, I've got to get back to my principal. So always go principal to principal if you're negotiating. Never go, you're the principal, to it with a non-principal. I don't know if I've confused that or not.
Yeah,
you understand it?
Yeah.
Well, then they'd understand it.
Yeah.
And so, I'm kind of avoiding your question.
Okay, I'll move on then if you'd like me to.
I got to know these. Look, yeah. I had 26 meetings with Putin, one on one, more or less, I think, and I'm not exactly sure. And every one of them started with, "How's your family?" So Laura and I went to his house, met his little girls, and there's, you know, a dad loves to talk about his kids and his daughters, and so I started off, "How's your daughters doing?" No matter how difficult the subject would be, the whole purpose was to try to create, you know, a human bridge, a connection, and then we'd get to the issues at hand.
So one of our scholars observes that obviously you all have an authentic friendship. You spend time together and really enjoy it, and I know you know some of the folks that are running for president. And so the question is, what are your thoughts on the way that the candidates can elevate the discourse so that it's foundational for governing? And then tell a few stories from the campaign trail. You've been on it for many years, both of you.
Yeah.
President Bush, you want to start?
Well, you know, I think the discourse generally is lowered by surrogates. And the internet is a brutal place these days for political figures because there's a high degree of anonymity. There's no personal responsibility whatsoever. People can say whatever they want to say, and it kind of becomes currency. I suspect, I know Jeb, and I'm confident Secretary Hillary will, you know, elevate the discourse. I can't attest to their surrogates. I can attest to this surrogate. I'm not going to be a surrogate, but it's. but I, you know, look, I think American people expect to be, you know, some sharp elbows in a campaign. I think what really discourages them post-campaign, that the inability to govern in a way that is, you know, is congenial, and hopefully that'll change. It tends to go in cycles, by the way.
Yeah. President Clinton, then we'll get to some funny stories.
I may be naive. They say you get naive when you get long in the tooth. you know, I think they ought to have these debates, both in the Republican primary and the Democratic primary. And I think that I expect it to be very vigorous in the primaries, and then whoever wins the two primaries will have a hard debate. But they need to keep in mind that what we are trying to do is to take the advantages America has, and as Mark Cuban said, we talked about it, we're well positioned, but we haven't proved yet that we can solve the problem that's bedeviling the world, that is that we can create so many jobs that we have a large percentage of our workforce in, and we can have shared prosperity. And we ought to show respect for the debate, by trying to be as specific and clear as we can about the policy choices before us. And we can trust the American people and ennoble the process just by saying, look, it's not that simple. If it were simple, we'd already done it. But these are the five things we think are most important, and this is what I would do about them. I think the more we can keep it on that, and the less we can just do what I see in the so much in the media today is this sort of culture of anger and resentment. We got to reside, you know, kind of rise above anger to answers. It resides above resentment to a real response. Because if you get this job, I can tell you, the next day, it doesn't matter what was wrong with your opponent in the election. Next day, you're on your own. You walk in there, and you don't have somebody to debate you sitting behind the Oval Office desk with you, whichever desk you pick. You got to show up for work and make decisions. So that's all I hope. I hope we clarify for the American people that this is a big bunch of choices. They're not simple, but we can do it. Look, the quality of these young people proves it, and the inherent assets and the system of freedom and choice we have proves it, but we got a lot of tough decisions to make. That's all I really care about, besides I know who I like to win. But the more important thing for America is that we know what the heck we're deciding on, and we make a pretty good decision.
So we're about to graduate these scholars. What advice do you have for them as they return to their communities? And, you know, obviously you heard Jake's call to action. What's your advice for them?
Don't watch a lot of TV.
Read like Mark Cuban.
That actually act, you know, do things. And don't be afraid of failure. I'm not worried about this crowd.
President Clinton?
Yeah, I agree with that. You know, the other thing I'd say is if it, whatever it is, doesn't work out, get up. I lost two elections. I was the youngest former governor in American history after the Reagan landslide. I had one guy appointed to the cabinet walk across Main Street in Little Rock to avoid being seen shaking hands with me for fear that the guy that beat me would fire him. That was a humbling experience. And I think you got to realize there's no personal ambition you have which can be extinguished by anybody else. Only you, by giving up your dreams, can extinguish them. And if it doesn't work out exactly like you intended, it'll still take you someplace interesting and you'll make a difference. So my advice is what George said, don't be afraid to fail, but you probably will, whether you're afraid to or not. And it's scary. You just got to get up. The world belongs to tomorrow, not yesterday. Don't give anybody else permission to take your life away. Just keep living and keep giving. And never make the perfect the enemy of the good. Never think that what I'm doing is too little to make a difference. That's not true. That's not true. Do something every day. Someday, for all of us, it'll be our last day. And what will matter were all the steps we took along the way and what they amounted to, not the home run we hit on day X. I wish you well.
President Bush, you want to add to that?
Huh?
I said, do you want to add to
that?
I
was stuck on that someday maybe your last day line. I thought that was pretty damn profound.
So this is maybe a good setup for this question. Our scholars have said that they were surprised by both of you, that you were not what they expected, because they thought, you know, what they read the newspaper.
One probably thought I couldn't read.
The other one thought I could, and they didn't realize it's impossible.
So how do you react to that with respect to the filter of the media and how to, you know, what that means for them as they try to present their, you know, true selves and have people understand who they are, understand, know their heart and so forth?
You know, I don't know. I mean, I think we're both pretty confident people. And if people don't get us, what we're all about, then, you know, you just got to keep moving on. I mean, there's, I try not to worry about it. I can't tell you the number of people who've told me that meet me say, you're a lot taller than I thought you were.
I'm not sure that's exactly what they meant. But
I've been 5'11 since I was 18. I don't know. I mean, image is image, and you got to be confident in what you believe in. If you have a set of beliefs that you're willing to defend, image doesn't matter. And yeah, you get people say things about you all the time, but if that's a criteria for success for you, then go into the fetal.
I would also say, you know, and if you cover political news, you have to realize that it's sort of in the nature of things. Conflict is better news than concord. Even though cooperation works better than conflict, if that's all you put on the evening news at night, you go broke. Mm. So the nature of evening news will be to make people into two-dimensional cartoons instead of three-dimensional people. Mm. It's just the nature of the beast. And I think, so you just need to always keep your little caution light burning in the back of your head on that. I also think the nature is, like if, let's suppose we were in a campaign against each other, he would have his narrative and I would have mine, and we would try to convince you, each of us, that our narrative was better than the others. That's okay. But the people covering the campaign, they develop a narrative too. A storyline, and when it's almost impossible for the real story to be the same as a storyline, and it's very hard for the American people to be well informed if the storyline swamped the real story. So you just have to keep all that in mind as you try to be good citizens and still show up. Most important thing is showing up.
So we want some people to show up for the second class of scholars, and we're launching the recruitment today, and people can apply, those who are watching live stream, at presidentialleadershipscholars.org. So for those who are pondering application to this awesome program, what advice do you have for those seeking a spot?
And email those that have just gone through it and see whether it's worth your time. I mean, there's no better testimony to what's happened than people getting ready to walk across this stage. And my advice is, I'm sure they'll be more than willing to share their stories with you or go to our websites. Don't you think it's a good idea?
I think that's an excellent idea, President Bush. President Clinton, what do you think? What advice would you have? Or how should we...
You're kind of running out of...
No, how should people distinguish themselves? I thought you were going to have more stories.
We're at the bottom of the barrel of the question. No. God, you know?
Okay.
Why don't you just get the graduation going?
Okay. Well, but first I have to ask you about being a grandparent. And you're about to have a second grandchild.
Yeah.
When we did this first time, when we started this program, he said to me that when you become a grandfather, you fall in love all over again. And that's what happened. Hillary and I have our granddaughter for 3 days. And I came down here and left her like to kill me today. But Hillary was ecstatic. And she wasn't a candidate for anything. She was grandmother of the year. And last night, my granddaughter, 9.5 months old, for the first time when I walked in the room, she said, oh, there's your granddad. And she turned around and pointed at me. That was worth more than anything anybody had said or done for me or paid to me or anything else. And I don't know a month of Sundays. Everything you said about it is true.
Yeah. Last night my granddaughter spoke to me in Mandarin.
Okay, I think that's the end of the program, I think. Everybody, please join me in thanking the two grandfathers. Thank you.
Glad you guys.
President Clinton, that was so excellent. Thank you. Really fun.
Now what are we going to do?
Okay, you're staying up here and I'm leaving.
Okay.
Now, please welcome Fred McClure.
Thank you. Daniel Anelho. Through his role as Chief Executive Officer of New Schools for Chicago, Daniel is leading efforts aimed at changing the conversation about school quality and educational policy for the city's poorest students. Irela Bogue. Irela is a bilingual public affairs consultant in Coral Gables, Florida. For her project, she's working to host a national summit aimed at encouraging diversity and inclusion in the environmental movement. Yasmin Bhatia. As the CEO of Uplift Education, a network of charter schools here in Dallas, Yasmin is developing a fellowship program for urban principals that strives to increase staff retention by finding new ways to re-inspire and engage them in the work. James Christian Blockwood. James Christian is a career member of the Senior Executive Service in the U.S. Government Accountability Office in Washington, D.C. His project connects federal government planners with leaders across non-government organizations to improve decision-making practices. Janelle Carter Brevard. Janelle is the president of the J. Carter Group in Herndon, Virginia. She launched the Moss Point Foundation for Academic Excellence in Moss Point, Mississippi, to help students build in-home libraries in order to increase reading scores, and just recently distributed over 1,000 books to students in Moss Point. Robin Bruce. Robin Bruce is the CEO of the Acton School of Business in Austin, Texas. She is customizing the school's graduate curriculum to expand entrepreneurial education into underserved communities. Virginia Buckingham. Jenny is Senior Director of the U.S. Public Affairs at Pfizer in Massachusetts. On September 11, 2001, Jenny was serving as the CEO of Logan Airport and dealt with the fallout of that day and its aftermath. She is developing a memoir on her experience to serve as a platform for her to teach, speak, and write about leadership and resilience. Davy Carter. Davy is the regional president for Centennial Bank in Jonesboro, Arkansas, and he's launching the Delta Return Initiative, a collective of local government and business leaders to provide structured mentoring for promising Arkansas Delta youth. Rachel Chiesa. Rachel is the CEO of Every Child Fed in Chantilly, Virginia. Her project takes an entrepreneurial approach to saving the lives of starving children in Zambia by locally producing and distributing the fortified peanut butter used to treat severe malnutrition. Anmay Chung. Anmay is the chief of partnerships at the Mozilla Foundation in Chicago, Illinois. Anmay is convening stakeholders to design research, policies, and practices, including digital credentials, that make skills learned out of school count towards college and career readiness standards. John Cogbell. As a commander in the United States Army, John Cogbell lost one of his soldiers to suicide in 2012. John founded the Warrior Partnership for Resilience to increase opportunities for active duty servicemen and women to participate in competitive athletic events and train in resiliency training facilities. Anmara Connolly. Anmara is a member of the City Years executive team in Washington, D.C. She's leading efforts to gather the stories of young people who have performed a year of service through a story collecting campaign aimed at inspiring others to serve and invest in service opportunities. Shelly Cryan. Shelly is a product manager for the software developer Charity Logic. She also leads a successful program in the Gambia, teaching teen girls photography skills so they can earn money and stay in school. She will launch a traveling photo expedition in the U.S. showcasing the girls' work to spark cross-cultural conversations and expand knowledge of West Africa. Cassie Farrelly. Cassie serves in the British Commonwealth Office supporting the British Consulate General in New York, New York. Cassie's project is to launch Bank On, an affordable personal banking and financial literacy program for families that do not currently have access to affordable financial services. Dean Felt. Dean is a partner in DLA Piper's global equity practice in San Francisco, California. Dean co-founded Transatlantic West to bring business, civic, and policy leaders from California together with their counterparts in Europe to facilitate dialogues and relationships to address critical issues in the transatlantic relationship. Sean Fellows. Sean serves as the Director of Government Affairs at the Rogich Group in Las Vegas, Nevada. Sean has partnered with the Las Vegas Pets for Vets chapter to provide a second chance for shelter pets by rescuing, training, and pairing them with military veterans who could benefit from a companion animal. Casey Gerald. Casey is the co-founder and CEO of MBAs Across America in New York, New York. Expanding on his current work to deploy teams of MBAs to support small businesses and communities that need them most, his project, MBA by 2020, will make high-impact service a core part of the MBA experience in the nation's business schools by the year 2020. Brian Goldsmith. Based in the Bay Area of California, Brian is the co-head of Cedars America, a leading equity crowdfunding company that is based in London. Brian has partnered with Generation Citizen to develop an action-based curriculum for civics education to inspire the next generation about democratic government and civic involvement. Hunter Phillips Goodman. Hunter is the executive director of development at the University of Central Arkansas in Conway, Arkansas. Hunter has co-founded the Impact National Conference dedicated to connecting, educating, and mobilizing college students to strengthen their communities through service, action, and advocacy. Holly Garden. Holly is a filmmaker and the CEO and co-founder of Girl Rising, a global movement for girls' education in New York. Holly's project is aimed at creating a training program on storytelling and movement building for young leaders. Tim Griff. Tim is the co-founder and CEO of the National Security Technology Accelerator in Austin, Texas. He has also launched the Veteran Entrepreneurship and Apprenticeship in Residence program to place qualified veterans with promising startup companies for a year to earn sweat equity in the business and then empower them to transition to new careers. Ramsey Green. Ramsey is a partner in GCE Green Development in New Orleans, Louisiana. His project is focused on making homes in coastal areas more resilient against the impact of hurricane force winds, thus lowering home insurance premiums. Neil Grunberg. Neil is a professor at the Uniformed Services University of Health Sciences in Bethesda, Maryland. He is developing the Medical Student Leadership Education and Development Summit to teach medical students how to lead 21st century healthcare teams, ensure patient safety, and contain costs in addition to their medical school education. Jake Harriman. Jake is the founder and CEO of Nuru International and is based in San Clemente, California. Nuru is creating lasting, meaningful choices for impoverished farmers in conflict states to create greater global stability and security by combining special operations combat experience with a new poverty eradication model. Terry Hasdorf. Terry serves as a vice president at Convoy of Hope in Washington, D.C., which started a women's empowerment program in Ethiopia. Terry is working to increase its impact by doubling the number of women in the program by expanding to Nicaragua, Tanzania, and Haiti. Kevin Hooks. Kevin is the CEO of the Las Vegas Urban League. His project is a reimagining of Black History Month. He is working to orchestrate a society-wide shift that changes the celebratory nature of Black History Month from historical to a forward-facing experience. Sarah Kay. Sarah is the director of corporate giving at Prudential Financial in Fort Lee, New Jersey. In response to an opposition base that is threatening to repeal education standards in New Jersey, Sarah has developed a diverse coalition of stakeholders to raise awareness and advocate for higher standards and assessments and help parents understand the importance of these standards. Niroff Kingsland. Niroff is an education consultant in New Orleans, Louisiana. Niroff's project is to have 10 major cities develop high-quality charter school sectors that serve a majority of public school students. This year, three cities have been put on track to achieve that goal. Cheryl Kirschenbaum. Cheryl is the executive director of Science Debate, based in East Lansing, Michigan. Science Debate works to persuade presidential candidates to participate in live science debates, discussing their science policy priorities. Topics covered will impact our children's future from energy and climate change to global leadership and innovation. Roy Lopez. Roy is a community development officer at the Dallas Federal Reserve Bank. Roy is creating an initiative that aims to help low to moderate income Dallas children and their families save and plan for college through savings accounts and financial capability workshops as a means of incubating college expectations at a very early age. James Lorraine. Jim is the founding director of the United States Special Operations Command Care Coalition in Aiken, South Carolina. He has developed the Warrior Fusion Center to revolutionize veteran support at the community level by creating an environment where government agencies transparently collaborate to solve the issues our veterans are facing. Diana Mao. Diana is the co-founder and president of the NOMI Network, and for the past 7 years, she has dedicated her life to creating economic opportunities for vulnerable women. Her project focuses on decreasing the child labor footprint of major brands with a long-term goal to have brands disseminate best practices and develop action plans to decrease their slavery footprint. Michael Marasha. Michael is a Chief Master Sergeant and Fire Chief at Scott Air Force Base. His project strengthens the relationship between Scott Air Force Base and neighboring community fire departments through training and mutual aid response. Clarissa Martinez de Castro. Clarissa serves as the Deputy Vice President at the National Council of La Raza in Washington, D.C. For her project, Clarissa is developing markers of bipartisan collaboration that can help the public identify problem-solving approaches among elected officials. Jim Malden. Jim is a medical support assistant for the Portland Veterans Administration in Oregon. His program, Operation School Kids and Veterans Engaged, provides veterans with opportunities to volunteer in schools and inspire school children with their experience and integrity, and in turn provide greater connections for veterans to their communities. Jennifer McCain. Jenny is an attorney for Maynard Cooper and Gale and the president and founder of Scholarships for Kids in Birmingham, Alabama. She has created a program to provide leaders with proven, strategic, and practical hands-on training to launch and grow tax credit scholarship organizations. In July 2016, she is organizing a national strategic training conference for 100 state legislators, nonprofit scholarship organizations, and school leaders. Michaela McMurrah. Michaela is an attorney in the litigation department of Cravath, Swain, and Moore in New York, New York. Michaela has developed a program that offers federal judges the opportunity to learn about the work of the national security and national intelligence agencies to better inform their decisions. William McNulty. William is a co-founder and president of Team Rubicon Global based in Marina del Rey, California. TRG addresses the search for new purpose for millions of veterans returning home, the struggles of aid agencies to respond to the increasing severity and frequency of natural disasters, and the global lack of innovative programs for returning veterans. Brian McPeak. Brian is the Chief Conservation Officer at the Nature Conservancy in Denver, Colorado. His long-term goal is to offer a realistic picture of a post-2050 world to help shape the organization's direction, build a coalition with other leading conservation NGOs, and publish a book that serves as a platform to engage broader audiences. Brian O'Donnell. Brian is the executive director of the Conservation Lands Foundation in Durango, Colorado. His project seeks to protect a region in southeastern Utah that contains more than 100,000 archaeological sites that is being threatened by looting, vandalism, and industrial development. Kavita Patel. Kavita is a fellow and managing director of the Engelberg Center for Healthcare Reform at the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. Kavita and her team have worked with educational institutions to develop a 20-hour curriculum which can be used to train lay healthcare workers in advanced care of chronic diseases. Patrick Payton. Patrick Payton is lead pastor at Stonegate Fellowship in Midland and Odessa, Texas. Patrick is working with the Business Funders Initiative, a group convened to address various areas of need in Midland, Texas, to make significant progress and improvement in the Midland schools. Jim Peterson. Jim is a physician health organization management consultant in Taos, New Mexico. Jim is working to form a local independent healthcare cooperative to provide a local sustainable healthcare benefits option that keeps more healthcare dollars in the local community and local economy, offers lower deductibles and out-of-pocket responsibilities, and provides excellent customer service to both patients and providers. Jay Reddy. Jay is the executive director of the Chicago Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law. He is developing a project called Innovation Houses to help young adults revitalize severely distressed neighborhoods by both living and working in those neighborhoods. Steve Ressler. Steve is a founder and CEO of GovLoop.com in Washington, D.C. His project, GovLoop Academy, is an online training academy with free, short, high-impact learning experiences for federal, state, and local government employees on topics ranging from leadership to technology to procurement. Darren Roberts. Darren is the founding director of the Center for Sports Leadership and Innovation at the University of Texas in Austin. His project, Captains Academy, partners with Austin Independent School District to train high school varsity captains in critical leadership skills. Dev Sangvi. Dev is Associate Chief Medical Officer for Duke University Health System in Durham, North Carolina. Dev is leading efforts to systematically identify and inventory unique partnerships, tested innovations, and established best practices in community-based healthcare in order to reduce healthcare costs and inefficiencies. Neil Cironi. Neil is Senior Director for Strategy and Planning for BAE Systems in Washington, D.C. Her project convenes a cross-section of respected leaders in national intelligence to tackle the challenges faced in security and intelligence in the digital age. Tracy Scott. Tracy is the 1st Infantry Division Regional Liaison Officer at Fort Riley, Kansas. Her project, the Green Dress Project, focuses on empowering young girls from underserved communities or those who may not otherwise have the means or resources to learn how to transition into and succeed in professional settings. Yeah. Joe Seliga. Joe is a partner at Mayor Brown in Chicago, Illinois. His project, Urban Exposure, is an immersive education experience that allows individuals in a group setting to learn about the neighborhoods they do not know that surround them and their residents that they might otherwise never gain exposure to. Will Simpson. Will is a deputy administrator at the Mississippi Department of Human Services in Jackson, Mississippi. With over 5,000 foster children in custody in Mississippi, Will recently launched a 6 to 8 week leadership program focusing on critical life skills for students aging out of foster care. Ted Smith. Ted is a partner, co-founder, and president of Union Square Advisors in San Francisco, California. His project is to replicate the success of Raphael House, which is helping families return to permanent housing and long-term economic stability in California to other communities across the country. Ann Sprudy. Ann Sprudy is the founder and CEO of Rally Point 6 in Lakewood, Washington. Her project is to scale the organization nationally and globally to bring together and leverage public and private sector veteran service providers and resources under one roof to better connect communities with the military. Michael Toledo. Michael is the executive director of Centro Hispano in Reading, Pennsylvania. For his project, Michael created a voter outreach and advocacy initiative to help educate Latinos on the issues affecting families to motivate and reinforce the importance of voting. Miro Vasilev. Miro is a chief investment officer at a New York-based global investment firm. For his project, Miro is producing a documentary film to help Americans understand and protect their families against the vast unchecked risk posed by the shadow banking system to our country's economic prosperity. Toby Vogt. Toby is a lieutenant and naval aviator in the United States Navy and is based in Pensacola, Florida. Toby has developed Service Match, a nonprofit concept focused on matching active duty military members with volunteer opportunities in their local communities to build networks and experiences that benefit both military members and civilian society. Gina Warner. Gina is the president and CEO of the National After School Association based in the Washington, D.C. area. Gina is leading the effort at the association to launch a leadership institute to ensure that after school professionals receive the skills and trainings they need to be effective. Enon Weiss. Enon is the co-founder and CEO of Rally Point and is based in Massachusetts. Through Rally Point, Enon is pursuing a partnership to provide education, mentorship, and training that will help military special forces achieve greater success as they transition to civilian life. Dale White. Dale is a lieutenant colonel in the United States Air Force. Dale's project is to provide science, technology, engineering, and math opportunities for high school students that have been left out of STEM activities due to lack of capacity in overcrowded schools. Carlos Williams. Carlos serves as a U.S. health attaché to the U.S. missions in Papua New Guinea, Fiji, and the Pacific Islands at large. Carlos has founded the Renaissance Red Foundation, a coalition for positive social transformation and development for young people that supports young professionals as agents of change through education, mentorship, and transformational experiences. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in once again congratulating our inaugural class of Presidential Leadership Scholars.
Good job, Freddie.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. President.
Please welcome Larry Temple, Chairman, Lyndon B. Johnson Presidential Library.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank President Clinton and President Bush on behalf of the LBJ Library and the LBJ Foundation. The Presidential Leadership Scholar Program was their brainchild and their implementation, although I heard tonight maybe it was Margaret's. I would say, Mr. President and Mr. President, we are in your debt for inviting us to participate in this absolutely stellar program. Well, tonight is a celebratory pause in a remarkable journey. None of you scholars were new to leadership when you came into this program. You were selected because you were already a leader in your own individual environment and with your own individual talent. The concept of the Presidential Leadership Scholars Program is to expose you to the historic actions and decision-making of past presidents to enhance your own skills and talents, and you have done that. While this program is historic, the lessons of leadership are timeless. There are no set attributes of leadership that apply to every person and every situation. At the Clinton Presidential Library, you examine the leadership principle of vision and communication. At the George W. Bush Presidential Center, you heard firsthand about the leadership principle of decision making. At the LBJ Library, you were exposed to leadership examples of the application of influence and persuasion, albeit sometimes a bit colorfully. At the George H.W. Bush Presidential Library, you learned about the examples of the leadership principle of coalition building. Those are some, but not all, of the facets of leadership. President Kennedy once said that leadership and learning are indispensable to each other. So you know you will always have to continue that learning process, because we all know that. Both when you were at the presidential libraries and again tonight, President Clinton and President Bush articulated some of their precepts of leadership. So tonight I thought that I might add the leadership pronouncements or statements of the other two presidents whose libraries you attended. President George H.W. Bush, Bush 41, once said, and I quote, "Where is it written that we must act as if we do not care, as if we are not moved? Well, I am moved. I want a kinder and gentler nation," end of his quote. And I would just say President Bush's entire career both embodied and epitomized the concepts of caring and compassion. LBJ said, and I quote, "If the leadership of our country supports us over the long, hard pull that lies ahead, if you can endure the tensions, if you can understand that the air is going to be rough and the road is going to be bumpy, you can, in the words of the Creed, help us unlock Earth's greatest treasure, human personality. Then the cussers and the doubters will be relegated to the rear, and the doers and the builders will take up the front lines." And that was the end of his quote. I would just say to this class, you are the doers and builders of this generation. One of the goals of the Presidential Leadership Scholars Program is to educate you about the lessons and styles of past presidents so that you can shape the future of our nation in your own ways. That future is now yours to develop. That is why I said at the outset that tonight only represents a pause in your journey. When Franklin Roosevelt died, Walter Lippmann, the preeminent journalist of his time, noted, "The final test of a leader is that he leaves behind him in other men the conviction and the will to carry on. The genius of a good leader is to leave behind him a situation which common sense, without the grace of genius, can deal with successfully. In this program, you have witnessed men and women who are some of the successful legacies of four presidents. You are now the legacies of three great living presidents and four presidential libraries. The question is, will you carry on what they started? Did they make a good investment in the time, information, and teaching that they provided to you? We will wait, watch, and see. Congratulations to all of you on your graduation."